Good morning to all. In this session, I am going to deal with the poem, The Temple Bell, which was written by B. Sugathakumari. The poem was originally written in Malayalam under the name Ambalamani. Now, let's discuss about the writer of the poem, B. Sugathakumari. Sugathakumari is an Indian poet and activist who has been at the forefront of environment and feminist movements in Kerala. She is influenced by her poet father's social activism and nationalistic fervor. As a founder of the Prakriti Samskrita Samiti, she has been in the forefront of environmentalist movement of Kerala right from its inception. Her concern for dissolute women has led to the establishment of the organization called Abhaya, of which she is the founder secretary. She has served as the principal of Jawahar Balabhavan and as the chairperson of Kerala State Women's Commission. Her early poems appeared under a male pseudonym in the Matrubhumi Weekly. Coming to her works, Muthuchippi, which was published in 1961, was her first book of poetry. Padirapookal, which was published in 1967, Ambalamani 1981, Kurunjipookal 1987, Tula Varsha Pacha 1990, etc. Sugathakumari is a recipient of Sahitya Academy and Kerala Sahitya Academy Award. She also received Odakudal Award, Vailar Award, Vallathol Award, Ashan Prize and Saraswati Samman. In 2006, the nation honored her with the Padma Shri. Her poems are marked by their pure lyrical quality and their strong sense of social commitment. Love and sadness are the two dominant emotions in her poems. Ecological concerns, romantic agony, existential anguish, and the women's quest for love appear as important themes in her work. Coming to the poem, The Temple Bell, Ambalamani is the title poem from Sugathakumari's 1981 collection. It mourns the loss of glorious past of a temple and pictures it in its inglorious present as it suffers the onslaught of negligence. The poem is a comment on the shallowness of contemporary life, expresses a sense of urgency in its plea to restore values that guided humanity in the past. The poem also uses many imagery, irony, metaphor and symbols to express her views. The poem was originally written in Malayalam under the name Ambalamani by Sugathakumari and it was translated into English by P.P. Ravindran. Now, let's move to the poem, The Temple Bell. Alone I watch and brood over the temple goburam, now a shambles the sanctum bat-infested, the ancient banyan tree crouching on its roots, the moss-covered pond, the empty hands of broken lamp holders, and the quiet deep solitude. In the first stanza, the poet calls for our attention to a dilapidated temple goburam with its bat-infested sanctum. So she is alone and she is watching the temple goburam. Now the temple is in a ruined condition and she also says that bat-infested sanctum. Sanctum sanctorum means the innermost part of the temple. It is the place where we usually keep the idols. In Malayalam, it is known as Sri Kovil. Near the temple, we can see an ancient banyan tree. The ancient banyan tree that embodies the glory of the temple is crouching on its roots. Next, a temple pond is also attached with this temple. But what is the condition of the temple pond now? The temple pond, the water of the temple pond is moss covered. That means that water is unused. So it was covered with moss. Next line, the empty hands of broken lamp holders. Usually in temples, we can see statues which are carved on the either side of the temple. In this temple also, we can see so many statues. The statues of the lamp holders have no more lamps in their hands. This lamp shows the light of spirituality and knowledge. This temple is very old, so we can't see any lamps or lights in that temple. What about the condition of that temple? The place is very quiet. It's deep solitude there. When I stand contemplating them, suddenly inside, the tinkling sound of a tender bell Who tarries here in this lonely gloom? The bell tolls to wake up whom? As I turn back in the dark, there hangs a bronze bell, its tinkling sound coming from no ringing hand, spilling over the wind. Next line. When I stand contemplating them, contemplating means thinking very seriously. When I stand contemplating them, suddenly inside the tinkling sound of a tender bell. So now the poet is watching and thinking very seriously about the present condition of the temple. Suddenly inside the tinkling sound of a tender bell. Suddenly inside from the temple, she is hearing the tinkling sound of a tender bell. The tinkling sound of a tender bell breaks the quiet and deep solitude of the temple. Coming to the next stanza, who tarries here in this lonely gloom? The bell tolls to wake up whom? In the second stanza, the poet Sukata Kumari is asking, who tarries here in this lonely gloom? Tarries means stay or waiting. Lonely gloom means it is very quiet there. So the poet is asking, who is waiting there in this lonely gloom? The bell tolls to wake up whom? The poet is again asking, for whom to wake up? This bell is making noise. As I turn back in the dark, there hangs a bronze bell, its tinkling sound coming from no ringing hand, spilling over the wind. As I turn back in the dark, there hangs a bronze bell. Suddenly she turns back and she notices a bronze bell which is hanging there. Its tinkling sound coming from no ringing hand, spilling over the wind. Nobody is there to ring that bell. It is the wind that is making the noise. The tinkling sound spilling over the wind from the bronze bell hanging in the front of Sanctum Sanctorum is the work of no human hand. Far, far away from the human touch, somewhat like a Munikanya in meditation, a broken temple bell that still chants though in shattered tunes. That means the bronze bell is hanging like a Munikanya in meditation. The deplorable condition of the temple is compared to that of a Munikanya, a recluse who lives in isolation with no interaction with mankind. So like a Munikanya in meditation, the bronze bell is hanging and it is far away from the human touch. A broken temple bell that still chants though in shattered tunes. That means though in shattered tunes means even though the tune from the bell is not clear, but the bell still chants. So that's the explanation for the second stanza. As I turn back in the dark, there hangs a bronze bell, its tinkling sound coming from no ringing hand, spilling over the wind, far, far away from the human touch, somewhat like a Munikanya in meditation, a broken temple bell that still chants, though in shattered tunes. Moving to the third stanza. And who is here to listen? A god turned to a mere rogue, or the rogues who come stealthily to carry away the god, or the horde of bats fluttering in the ruins, or the sulking night spirit. And who is here to listen? Again, the poet is asking, who is here to listen? A god turned to a mere rogue. The poet, with a tinge of irony, asks, who listened to these chants in shattered tunes? The god has turned to a mere rock. Or the rogues who come stealthily to carry away the god, or the horde of bats fluttering in the ruins, or the sulking night spirit. Will the rogues, rogues means vagabonds or criminals, who stealthily carried away the god, or the horde of the bats fluttering in ruins. That means the temple is now in the dilapidated or the ruined condition, and now it is the living place of bats. So the poet is asking, the horde of bats which is fluttering in the ruins, or the wandering spirit or the sulking night spirit, that means wandering night spirit, listen to these chants for whom this bell is ringing. So in the third stanza, the poet is asking so many questions. These are the questions asked by the poet in the third stanza. Coming to the fourth stanza of the poem, this bell that now chimes in the wind was once cast in bronze in smelting heat and hung up above in the holy corridor by someone, his palms joined together in prayers in times redolent with fragrant flowers and lamps shining bright as the bell spread its radiance on the gourd all smeared in sandal paste, the bell that hummed songs at the touch of the wind whispered the excited people. Now in the stanza, the poet is speaking about the history of the bell. This bell that now chimes in the wind was once cast in bronze in smelting heat. That means the poet reminds us that the bell that now chimes in the wind was once cast in bronze in the smelting heat. That means this bell was made with high heat and hung up above in the holy corridor by someone. It was a precious gift of someone, maybe a devotee, and it was placed in holy corridor, that means God's corridor. His palms joined together in prayers, that means he placed that bell with prayerful arms, or he joined his palms together to pray. Coming to the next line, in times redolent with fragrant flowers and lamps shining bright, as the bell spread its radiance on the gourd all smeared in sandal paste. These lines shows the prosperous year of the temple in the past. The fragrant flowers, bright shining lamps and the sandal paste smeared gourd are all bright images of the past. This line shows that the temple had a good history. At that time, the sanctum sanctorum was smelled. Redolent means smelt with fragrant flowers. This bell spread its radiance on the gourds smeared in sandal paste. But what is the condition now? But the condition of the temple now is very pathetic. The temple is in a dilapidated condition and the bell is also ruined. The bell that hummed songs at the touch of the wind whispered the excited people. That means the bell which hummed songs at the touch of the wind whispered the noise of the excited people in the past. In the ancient times, the bell makes a good sound, but now the bell makes only a low sound. So, in the fourth stanza, the poet describes about the prosperous history of the temple and also about the bell. The temple bell, its edges cracked, it still sings to the wind's touch, but who is there to listen now? How to hear this tingle amidst the market's din and the leader's roar in the public square? Who cares for this frail, feeble music amidst lusty, lurid songs sizzling away in movie theaters? The temple bell, its edges cracked. The bell which hymned songs at the touch of the wind now is cracked at its edges. Maybe the edges of the bell is now cracked. It still sings to the wind's touch, but who is there to listen now? But the bell is still singing at the wind's touch. But the bell still doesn't leave its zest for melody at the wind's touch. But who is there to listen now? So the poet is asking again and again, who is here to listen the sound of the bell? Coming to the next line, how to hear this tingle amidst the market's din and the leader's roar in the public square? Who cares for this frail, feeble music amidst lusty, lurid songs sizzling away in movie theaters? How to hear this tingle amidst the market's din and the leader's roar in the public square? The poet says that The frail song of the bell flutters amidst the market's din and the lyre's roar. It cannot withstand the lusty, lurid songs sizzling away in movie theaters. We are now living in a busy world. The jarring tone of commercialization and scramble for power and the lurid songs of modern day movies, all of which are symbols of the materialistic world. All these sounds has made the sound of the bell feeble and frail. Who cares for this frail, feeble music amidst lusty, lurid songs sizzling away in movie theaters? So the poet is asking, who cares this frail and feeble song? The sound of the bell is very low. Nobody cares to hear the sound, but the bell is still singing. The lights are out. Exit all. Exit the priest too, famished, leaving the god alone in the dark. Yet, why this crying from the bell? Jarring notes in the lonely dark. Perhaps it is doing its dharma, singing out songs now faded that once it sang to glory. The lights are out, exit all. Exit the priest too, famished, leaving the god alone in the dark. The famished priest too leaves the god in the dark. He was in search of new green pastures. The idol is alone in the temple. There is no light or lamp in the temple. The priest leaves the idol in the dark and they exit. Next stanza. Yet, why this chime from the bell? Jarring notes in the lonely dark. Perhaps it is doing its dharma, singing out songs now faded that once it sang to glory. The poet is again asking the same question, for whom the bell is ringing? For whom the jarring notes are produced in the lonely dark still remains as a question, and the poet reaches the idea that perhaps it is doing its dharma, singing out songs. The bell has not forgotten its duty or dharma and continues to sing, but people have no realization of their duties. Once it sang to glory, but now its song faded and no one is interested to hear its song. It sings of the spade that reached out in the dark mine where it lay asleep, of the god of fire who sanctified it in the heat of meditation, of the ancient dawn that gifted its melody, of the hand that hung it up here in prayer and then wiped the streaming tears of the lustre of the primal sound echoing inside every day. In this stanza, the bell remembers its makers and the process of its making. It sings of the spade that reached out in the dark mine where it lay asleep. The faded song from the bell echoes the memories of the spade which brought out the bronze block of the dark mine where it lay asleep. So, maybe with the help of the spade, the bronze is dug up. So, the song echoes the memories of spade which brought out the bronze in the dark mine where it was lying asleep. Of the god of fire who sanctified it in the heat of meditation. That means, after digging, the god of fire which sanctified that bell with the heat of meditation, of the ancient dawn that gifted its melody. And the god gifted the bell with the song of melody. Of the hand that hung it up here in prayer and then wiped the streaming tears of the luster of primal sound echoing inside every day. That means the bell is hearing the sound, the primal sound, maybe it is the sound of Omkaram or Omkara sound echoing inside every day. So the bell may be sanctified by the god of fire with the heat of meditation of the remote dawn, and it was blessed with the gift of melody and the luster of the primal sound. That sound may be the sound of Omkara or Omkara. So that's the gist of the stanza. It sings of the spade that reached out in the dark mine where it lay asleep, of the god of fire who sanctified it in the heat of meditation, of the ancient dawn that gifted its melody, of the hand that hung it up here in prayer and then wiped the streaming tears, of the luster of the primal sound echoing inside every day. So with the help of the spade, the bronze was dug up and the god of fire has sanctified it. Sanctified means purified. Purified it with the heat of meditation, and it was blessed with the gift of melody and the luster of primal sound. The primal sound was the sound of Omkara or Omkaram, and the bell is hearing this primal sound every day inside the temple. Moving to the next stanza, roused is the life spirit even now to the bell's lonely tingle, the sound of the conch in the temple, the procession carrying the golden idol, seven gold-decked elephants swaying in a row, the congregation of men around the yard, rows of lamps shone in their hearts as figures of beauteous women ranged on the pillars, and a hundred hands lifted to ring the bell, all in a chorus calling out to God. Roused is the life spirit even now to the bell's lonely tingle. That means when the bell tingles, the life spirit of the temple awakens. Sugata Kumari realizes the life spirit which evolves at the lonely tingle of the bell. The bell is lonely in that sanctum, but still it is ringing. The sound of the conch in the temple, that means the poet hears the lost reminiscence of the sound of conch in the temple. The procession carrying the golden idol, seven gold-decked elephants swaying in a row. The visual treat of a procession carrying the golden idol, seven gold-decked elephants swaying in a row. That means seven elephants are arranged in a row. Sugata Kumari is standing in the premises of the temple. She can hear the lost reminiscence of the temple. The congregation of men around the yard, that means the men assembled in the yard. Rows of lamps shone in their hearts as figures of beauteous women ranged on the pillars, and a hundred hands lifted to ring the bell, all in a chorus calling out to God. Here the poet is remembering about the past. In the past, when devotees came to visit the temple, maybe hundred of beauteous hands lifted to ring the bell, all in a chorus calling out the God. The poet is standing in the premises of the temple, and now she can hear the lost reminiscence of the temple. The empty hands of the broken lamp holders now glitter the premises with hundreds of lamps as figures of beauteous women ranged on the pillars. The vibrant and electrifying mood of religious activity of past days is brought alive by the tingling of the bell, but it has no impact on the mind of men. In the past, men used to assemble in the yard, and when devotees came to visit the temple, maybe hundred of beauteous hands lifted to ring the bell in a chorus calling out the God. It was the case with the past, but what is the condition of the temple now? There is no one to visit there, and we can't see any devotee or any single person in that temple. So there is no one to lit the lamp, and even the priest left the idol in darkness. This is the condition of temple now. But in this stanza, Sugata Kumari is thinking about the lost glory of the temple. The visual treat of a procession carrying the golden idol, seven gold-decked elephants swaying in a row, men assembled in the yard, hundreds of beauteous women lifted their hands to ring the bell all in a chorus. These all shows the glory of the temple in the past. But now, what is the condition of the temple now? The temple is in a dilapidated or ruined condition, and there is no one or even not even a single person visit that temple, and all the glory of the temple has lost. So in this stanza, Sugata Kumari is describing about the lost glory of the temple. Coming to the last stanza of the poem, but there are no takers, not a soul to listen. In this long night, you who dare to stay alone here in this temple yard, melody incarnate, you who would awaken to the touch of the wind, though of faded sound and mimed at the rim, let me for once greet you and stand before you in prayer. But there are no takers, not a soul to listen. That means, initially there were lot of people to listen to the bell. But what is the condition now? The idol is alone in the temple and no one is there to listen. Not even a soul is there to listen to the song of the bell. Coming to the last stanza, in this long night, you who dare to stay alone here in this temple yard, melody incarnate, you who would awaken to the touch of the wind, though of faded sound and mimed at the rim, let me for once greet you and stand before you in prayer. In this long night, you who dare to stay alone, that means the bell dares to stay alone as an incarnation of melody in this long night. So, the temple is alone in the temple yard. Here in this temple yard, melody incarnate. That means when the wind blows, the bell started ringing. When the bell started ringing, there comes a faded sound. Let me for once greet you and stand before you in prayer. Towards the end of the poem, the sound of the bell inspires the poet a lot. So, she concludes the poem by saying that, let me for once greet you and stand before you in prayer. That means, she is asking the bell to allow her to stand before it in the prayer. When the poet folds his arms in prayer to the bell, there is a hope that the splendid past of spirituality shall come again and man's conscience will once again respond to the voice of his gods rather than his conscience, that is the dwelling place of gods. This poem is an appeal to restore religious faith in our day-to-day life of the hectic world. That sensitive poetic heart, lamenting on the degradation of ethics followed by society, now pins for a restatement of spiritual values in our life. The poem is an eye-opener towards the dilapidated state of temple, sacred grove, and our culture in general. One might also read the poem as a sincere call for restoring the dignity of poetry in the contemporary life. Now let's discuss about the imagery used in the poem. By addressing the abandoned temple bell as a Munikanya in meditation, the poet attributes femininity to the bell. In the original version in Malayalam, the concluding lines also speak of a woman who dares to stay alone in the lonely temple yard. The symbol of bell evokes the image of an old spinster who once spread the light of hope and happiness around her, but now ended in a bat-infested sanctum sanctorum, abandoned by all. The imagery, metaphor, and symbols employed in the poem are natural and powerful. Bat-infested sanctum, banyan tree crouching on its roots, moss-covered pond, broken lamp holders, a broken temple bell in solitude, all the images are thoroughly carved out and evoke an element of sympathy to the temple which is waiting its imminent death. Now let's conclude the poem. As a whole, the poem is a call to refresh the state of poetry and to uphold the relevance of adherence to dharma or religious faith in this hypocritical shallow world. By presenting a bell that sings its own creation, the poet hints at the necessity of worshipping one's creator and also realizing that we all have a little God inside of us. It is in our own mind that God dwells. It is to our own divinity that is an integral part of the universe that we appeal to in our prayers. The poet is fed up with all the pretensions of the contemporary life and now finds refuge only in deep prayer. The poem was originally written in Malayalam under the name Ambalamani by Sugatha Kumari, and it was translated into English by P.P. Ravindran under the name The Temple Bell. So that's all about the poem. Hope you understood the poem The Temple Bell, written by B. Sugatha Kumari. Thank you for watching.